Welcome, everyone. Today, we're going to explore corrosion and corrosion control, starting with an overview. This is the first slide, so I want to warmly welcome you all and thank you for being here. The focus of our presentation is on corrosion basics, which will help us understand the fundamentals of corrosion and how to manage it effectively. Over the next few slides, we'll cover key concepts, causes, prevention methods, and control strategies. I'm excited to take you through this important topic, so let's get started. Let's take a closer look at the key objectives for today's discussion. First, we'll start with an introduction to corrosion, which is essential for understanding why it's such a challenge in various industries. Then, we'll explore the different types of damage mechanisms that corrosion can cause, helping us identify how it impacts materials over time. Finally, we'll cover corrosion mitigation methods. These are the strategies and techniques used to prevent or reduce corrosion, ensuring the longevity and safety of structures and equipment. Connecting these points to the overall theme, understanding these fundamentals is crucial for developing effective solutions and maintaining the integrity of engineering systems. Let's talk about the basics of corrosion. Corrosion is essentially the deterioration of a material, most often metals, caused by a reaction with its environment. Think of it as the material slowly breaking down because it's interacting with things like moisture, oxygen, or other chemicals around it. A famous saying in this field is "corrosion never sleeps," because it's an ongoing process that can happen anytime, anywhere. And the impact of corrosion isn't just technical. It has huge economic consequences too. In fact, the annual cost of corrosion is estimated to be around $2.5 trillion globally, according to the World Corrosion Organization. Understanding these fundamentals helps us see why corrosion control is so important across industries. It's not just about preserving materials, but also about saving money and ensuring safety over the long term. Let's start by looking at the basics of corrosion. Pure metal is actually in a high energy state. This means it has a lot of stored energy that makes it reactive. Because of this, it tends to react with other elements around it. When it reacts, it's essentially trying to revert to a more stable, lower energy state. This is the fundamental driving force behind corrosion. Understanding this helps us see why metals corrode in the first place. It's all about seeking stability. Recognizing this concept is key as we explore how corrosion happens and how we can prevent it in different environments. Let's take a closer look at the basics of corrosion and the different damage mechanisms involved. Generally, we can divide these mechanisms into several key categories. First, there's general corrosion, which involves a uniform or localized loss of material thickness across a surface. This means the metal can be thinned evenly or in specific spots, depending on the environment and conditions. Next, we have environment-assisted cracking, where external factors like stress or specific environmental conditions cause cracks to develop and propagate in the material. This is a more insidious form of damage because it can occur even without obvious uniform degradation. Then, we encounter mechanical and metallurgical failure mechanisms. These are failures related to the material's own properties or external mechanical forces, things like fatigue, stress corrosion cracking, or phase changes within the metal that weaken it over time. Finally, there's high temperature corrosion, which is particularly relevant in environments where metals are exposed to elevated temperatures. In these conditions, corrosion processes can accelerate or change form, leading to different types of damage compared to corrosion at room temperature. Understanding these categories helps us identify, prevent, and mitigate corrosion-related failures in various engineering applications. Each mechanism has unique characteristics and challenges, but recognizing them is a crucial step in maintaining the integrity of our materials and structures. Let's take a closer look at the basics of corrosion. When we talk about general corrosion, we're referring to the uniform or localized loss of material thickness over a surface. This can happen in various forms, and some of the most common include galvanic corrosion, which occurs when two different metals are in contact in a corrosive environment. Atmospheric corrosion is another widespread type, caused by exposure to air and moisture, leading to rust and degradation over time. We also see corrosion under insulation, often abbreviated as CUI, where moisture gets trapped beneath insulation materials, causing hidden damage. Boiler water condensate corrosion happens when condensate forms inside boilers, leading to corrosion of internal surfaces. CO2 corrosion is particularly relevant in pipelines and systems where carbon dioxide dissolves in water, creating acidic conditions that accelerate rust. Flue gas dew point corrosion occurs when flue gases cool and condense, leading to corrosive attacks on boiler or chimney components. Microbiologically induced corrosion, or MIC, involves bacteria that produce corrosive byproducts, significantly impacting pipelines and tanks. And finally, soil corrosion refers to the deterioration of buried structures due to contact with soil, moisture, and microorganisms. All these types of corrosion, whether uniform or localized, highlight how diverse and pervasive corrosion can be. Understanding these different forms is crucial because each one requires specific strategies for prevention and control. Throughout this presentation, we'll see how recognizing these types helps us better protect our assets and extend their lifespan. Let's take a closer look at corrosion basics through a schematic representation of a corrosion cell. As you can see here, the diagram illustrates how corrosion actually occurs at the microscopic level. Essentially, a corrosion cell consists of two different areas on a metal surface, one that acts as the anode and one that acts as the cathode. The anode is where oxidation happens, meaning metal atoms lose electrons and turn into ions. Meanwhile, the cathode is where reduction occurs, typically involving the gain of electrons by other substances, like oxygen or water. This electrochemical process creates a flow of electrons between these two points, which leads to material degradation over time. Understanding this schematic helps us grasp the fundamental mechanics of corrosion, how it starts, spreads, and how different factors can influence its rate. Recognizing these key concepts is crucial because it allows us to develop effective strategies to prevent or control corrosion in our systems. So, when we think about corrosion prevention, we're essentially aiming to interrupt or modify this electrochemical process depicted here. Let's take a closer look at corrosion basics, starting with atmospheric corrosion. This type of corrosion occurs when metals are exposed to the environment, specifically to the air and moisture around us. It's one of the most common forms and can happen almost anywhere. The key point here is that atmospheric corrosion is influenced by factors like humidity, temperature, and the presence of pollutants such as sulfur dioxide or salt from sea air. These elements accelerate the corrosion process. Understanding this helps us appreciate why certain environments are more aggressive and why protective measures are essential. Connecting this to the overall theme, recognizing atmospheric corrosion is fundamental because it affects the durability of structures and materials we rely on every day. It highlights the importance of proper material selection and protective coatings to prevent costly damage over time. Let's take a closer look at corrosion basics, specifically focusing on corrosion under insulation. Now, this is a critical area because insulation often covers piping and equipment, making it harder to detect issues early. When corrosion occurs beneath insulation, it can develop unnoticed, leading to significant damage before it's even visible. This type of corrosion is particularly insidious because the insulation provides a protective barrier that traps moisture and creates a humid environment, which accelerates the corrosion process. Understanding this helps us realize why proper inspection and maintenance are essential, even when everything appears fine on the surface. It's important to consider that corrosion under insulation can cause leaks, failures, and costly repairs if left unchecked. So, in the context of overall corrosion management, addressing corrosion under insulation is vital. It reminds us that our corrosion prevention strategies need to include not only the exposed surfaces, but also those hidden beneath insulation. By staying vigilant and proactive, we can prevent costly issues and extend the lifespan of our assets. Let's take a closer look at corrosion basics, specifically the concept of environment-assisted cracking. This occurs when there's a combination of stress and environmental factors that contribute to material failure. It's important to understand that this isn't just about the mechanical stress alone, but how certain environments can accelerate cracking. For example, chloride stress corrosion cracking, or CLSCC, is a common issue in environments with high chloride concentrations, like seawater or de-icing salts. It causes cracks to form and propagate along the material, often with little warning. Corrosion fatigue is another key point, where cyclic stresses combined with corrosive environments lead to faster crack growth than would occur with stress alone. This is especially relevant in dynamic applications like pipelines or machinery. Wet H2S damage involves various forms of deterioration, including blistering, hydrogen-induced cracking, or SOHIC, sulfide stress cracking. These issues are common in oil and gas environments and can be quite severe. We also need to consider amine stress corrosion cracking, which can occur in chemical processing plants where amine solutions are used, and carbonate stress corrosion cracking, often seen in carbonatrich environments. All these forms highlight how different environments, when combined with stress, can significantly impact the integrity of materials. Recognizing these mechanisms is crucial for designing more durable systems and preventing unexpected failures. Let's take a closer look at the basics of corrosion and the various failure mechanisms that can occur in materials. Some of these mechanisms are quite common, but it's important to remember that they can also overlap or work together in complex ways. For example, graphitization is a process where carbon structures chain, which can weaken the material over time. Erosion and erosion corrosion happen when particles or fluids physically wear away the material, often accelerated in harsh environments. Mechanical fatigue is another critical factor. This is the progressive damage that occurs when a material is subjected to repeated cyclic stresses. Vibration-induced fatigue is similar but specifically driven by vibrations that cause cracks to form and propagate. Refractory degradation relates to the breakdown of high-temperature materials used in furnaces or reactors, which can compromise their integrity. Then there's creep and stress rupture, where materials deform slowly under constant high stress and temperature, eventually leading to failure. All these mechanisms highlight how diverse and interconnected failure modes can be, emphasizing the need for a comprehensive understanding of corrosion and failure in maintaining reliable, long-lasting systems. Let's take a closer look at high-temperature corrosion. This type of corrosion occurs when gases, solid or molten salts, or even molten metals attack materials at elevated temperatures, typically above 750 degrees Fahrenheit or 400 degrees Celsius. At these high temperatures, the materials become vulnerable to various chemical reactions. Some of the most common forms include oxidation, where metals react with oxygen to form oxides, sulfidation, which involves reactions with sulfur gases, carburization, where carbon diffuses into the metal surface, and metal dusting, a process where fine metal particles are formed and flaked off. We also see fuel ash corrosion, which happens when ash deposits from fuel combustion interact with metal surfaces. Understanding these processes is crucial because they can significantly affect the durability and safety of equipment operating under high-temperature conditions. Recognizing the key types of high-temperature corrosion helps us develop better materials and protective strategies, ultimately supporting the overall goal of enhancing system longevity and performance. Let's dive into corrosion mitigation methods. First, material selection and design are crucial because choosing the right materials and designing structures properly can significantly reduce corrosion risks. For example, selecting corrosion-resistant alloys or designing for proper drainage can make a big difference. Next, protective coatings act as a barrier between the metal and its environment, preventing corrosive elements from reaching the surface. These coatings are often the first line of defense. Moving on, cathodic protection involves making the metal act as a cathode in an electrochemical cell, which helps prevent corrosion, especially in pipelines and tanks. Lastly, chemical treatments can be applied to neutralize corrosive agents or passivate surfaces, providing an additional layer of protection. Together, these methods form a comprehensive approach to managing corrosion and extending the life of our structures. let's take a closer look at corrosion basics, specifically focusing on material selection and design. When choosing materials for a project, it's crucial to consider the entire life cycle costs. This means thinking beyond just the initial purchase price and looking at long-term durability and maintenance expenses. The right material can significantly reduce corrosion-related issues and extend the lifespan of the equipment. For example, depending on the process requirements, we might select materials like carbon steel for less aggressive environments, corrosion-resistant alloys for more demanding conditions, or even non-metallic materials when appropriate. The key is to match the material of construction to the specific process environment. This ensures optimal performance and cost efficiency over time. By carefully selecting materials based on these factors, we can design systems that are both reliable and cost-effective, aligning with the overall goal of minimizing corrosion risks throughout the life cycle. Let's take a closer look at corrosion basics, starting with protective coatings. Essentially, these coatings act as a barrier, cutting off the electrolyte and preventing the transfer of electrons and ions that drive corrosion within a corrosion cell. By doing so, they significantly slow down or even stop the corrosion process. When choosing a protective coating, it's important to consider the environment and the specific service conditions the material will face. Factors like temperature, whether the surface needs to be insulated or uninsulated, and the overall exposure all play a crucial role in selecting the right coating. To ensure the coating performs at its best, we need to make the right choice based on these criteria. Proper selection is key, but equally important is maintaining good quality control practices during application. This ensures the coating adheres properly and provides the intended protection over time. Remember, a well-chosen, properly applied protective coating is vital for extending the lifespan of your assets and preventing costly corrosion-related failures. Let's talk about cathodic protection, which is a key method for preventing corrosion. The basic idea is to make the structure that needs protection become the cathode of an electrochemical cell. By doing this, we effectively stop the corrosion process from happening. There are two main types of cathodic protection systems to consider. The first is sacrificial anodes. These are pieces of metal that are more reactive than the protected structure. They corrode in place of the structure, providing a kind of sacrifice to protect the integrity of the main metal. The second type is impressed current. In this system, we use an external power source to supply a steady flow of electricity. This current is directed to the structure, ensuring it remains the cathode and stays protected from corrosion. Both methods are crucial tools in our corrosion prevention arsenal, and choosing between them depends on the specific application and environment. Understanding how these systems work helps us better design and maintain infrastructure that lasts longer and stays safer over time. Now, let's talk about chemical treatment as a key strategy in corrosion prevention. One of the main approaches is using corrosion inhibitors to protect materials from degrading. These inhibitors are carefully selected based on the specific service conditions and the type of corrodents involved. For example, magnesium oxide and magnesium compounds are often used as inhibitors to prevent corrosion in boilers. They help by forming protective films that reduce the metal's exposure to corrosive agents. Another important chemical treatment involves oxygen scavengers, which work to lower the oxygen content in the system. Since oxygen is a major driver of corrosion, especially in water systems, removing it significantly slows down the corrosion process. Overall, chemical treatment is a vital part of our corrosion management strategy, tailored to the particular environment to effectively minimize damage and extend equipment life. Thank you so much for your attention today. I really appreciate your time and engagement throughout this presentation. I hope the key points we've discussed have given you valuable insights and a clearer understanding of the topic. Remember, the ideas and strategies we've covered are all aimed at helping you achieve your goals more effectively. If you take away one thing from today, I hope it's the importance of applying these concepts thoughtfully and confidently in your own work. Thanks again for being such an attentive audience. Have a great day.